When I got the topic, breaking barriers, when Tanmay called and told me about breaking barriers, you know, the first thing we usually do whenever we get a topic is to Google. So I did a simple Google search on the topic, breaking barriers, and I wanted to see what are the images that are coming for breaking barriers. And along with that, I also did something else. I was seeing breaking barriers and bridging barriers. This is the one picture I got for breaking barriers, perhaps the first picture. This is the one I got for bridging barriers. Now, there is a conceptual difference. There is a paradigm difference between these two pictures. Then again, I tried with another picture. Breaking barriers, and I was Googling building bridges. There is a crucial difference between the picture on one side and the picture on the other side. And I believe this is the very critical and crucial aspect how we deal with such an issue like boundary, barriers, and anything that's meant to be broken as per the theme of TEDxNMIMS. And what's the conceptual difference that we are looking at? Breaking can or may be seen as aggressive, harsh, something that's meant to be broken, harsh, too violent, and building can be seen as creative and positive. Many people do find comfort in barriers, boundaries, and please remember, whenever we speak about breaking barriers, these barriers have a history of themselves. These boundaries have a history, they do not arise from vacuum. So many people do find some kind of comfort in their own comfort zones, their own barriers, their own boundaries. But the better thing, we may not be able to break all the walls in the world, but we can definitely build doors. This is the conceptual and the paradigm difference we can make to a very critical topic like barriers and boundaries. And please remember, everywhere in the world, every one of us we all have our own barriers and boundaries. So how do we deal with this? How do we, even in a nation like, in a very pluralistic, diverse nation like India, we have all the religions, all the faiths, all the races, all the languages. If somebody is to call all these languages and identities as barriers, suddenly those people inside these barriers and those people who find this very appealing to them, find this in their comfort zone, find a sense of belongingness to this, will have a problem about breaking the barriers. And what can we do? The best thing about in a multicultural, multi-faith, multi-religious, multilingual world, in a modern global village where you have 700 crore people belonging to different identities, the ideal thing is to bridge the barriers rather than break the barriers. When you break the barriers, it will sound aggressive, violent, it will sound too harsh, but when you build bridges, it will be seen as much more of a creative, constructive, positive thing. And the best thing about bridge building is it is creative. It is not breaking something. We are creating something. We are generating something. We are doing something new so that there is something positive. And this is the philosophical difference between breaking barriers and bridging barriers. I totally agree with the essence and spirit of your theme, breaking barriers, but I would like to rephrase breaking barriers, or I would like to evolve the whole theme of breaking barriers into how to bridge barriers. And who was such a great bridge builder in the past century? If you look at human history, bridge building has been a very crucial idea. And please remember, you know, if there is no bridge in the world, there is no connectivity between spaces. If you look at Bombay, if you look at the place where I come from, Kerala, if you look at London or New York, bridges really connect different spheres and different spaces. If this is about geography, what about psychology? What about philosophy? What about sociology? Who was the greatest bridge builder of the past century? And I would like to take your attention to the greatest bridge builder of the past century. This person, this young guy, grew up to be one of the greatest bridge builders of the past century. Not only in India, but world over. A person who was respected across the spectrum, across the world. When I was studying in London School of Economics, I met with a very budding, eminent politician in London. So he said, I am currently studying about this person. I said, I'm surprised. As an Indian who grew up in India, I never had a serious thought about this person who I studied. Then I started exploring more about this person after my British friend, British who ruled us for 200 years, this person who caused the British to move out of India and who liberated India, the person who gave us independence, I started to study more about Gandhiji, the father of our nation. And being a bridge builder, Gandhiji, Albert Einstein spoke about Gandhiji in such glowing terms. Albert Einstein is considered one of the greatest intellects of all time, one of the greatest symbols of being intelligent, intelligentsia, scientist, a person who is equally a scientist and a mystic. And Einstein, Albert Einstein, told about Gandhiji, coming generations may scarce believe that such a man in flesh and blood existed on earth. He is the most enlightened of all men of our time. And Martin Luther King, the famous person in the US who worked for the upliftment of the black brothers there, who worked for their rights there, went on to say that Jesus showed us the idea. He was a religious preacher, and he said Jesus showed the idea, but Gandhi gave the method. Gandhi unpacked the life of Jesus more than anybody in history. Martin Luther King, one of the greatest activists of the past century, we all will recollect, I have a dream speech. He said, if humanity is to progress, Gandhi is inescapable. He lived, thought, and acted inspired by the vision of humanity, evolving towards a world of peace and harmony. If we have to ignore him, we have to ignore Gandhi at our own risk. And many a times back in India, I feel, apart from the currency notes we have, we are ignoring Gandhi a big time, especially Gandhian philosophy and Gandhian paradigm. And coming to all the major people in the world, whether it is Nelson Mandela, Dalai Lama, or Obama, and many of you might have heard about the famous Obama story, where Obama, when he was the president of the United States of America, he was asked, name one person in history, whether dead or alive, who would like to, you would like to have a dinner with. And Obama said, Gandhi is a hero of mine. And if I had such an option from the past, that particular person would be Mahatma Gandhi. And similar was the statement by Dalai Lama. But what impressed me was what Harish Majike said. He was the South African ambassador to India. He said, if Mandela is the father of our nation, Gandhi is the grandfather of our nation. Such was the respect for Gandhiji across US, across Europe, across Africa, across different spheres of the world. And what is Gandhism in a nutshell? What do we mean by a Gandhian approach in a nutshell? As we rightly know, many of the positions of Gandhiji at that point of time is right now outdated. He was against what he saw as overwhelming and competing technology against the human space. But what is Gandhism in general? Gandhism is more of an approach rather than certain socio-political positions. Gandhism is mutual respect and inherent respect for human goodness. Dialogue, debate, samvad, what we call, let us talk to each other, let us find a way out, consensus, middle ground, pluralism plus faith in God, non-violence, ahimsa, satyagraha, and truth. This is Gandhism in a nutshell. It's not an ism per se. When you say ism, the word ism means ideology or philosophy. But Gandhism is more of an approach, less of a very constricted dogma. Gandhism is more of an understanding of the world and approach we take towards the world. And look at how he will build a consensus. It's a very interesting thing. Many of you might, especially we, after studying in Nehruvian India for the past 60 years, we are taught in our history books regarding saffron, white, and green, our tricolor flag, in a very particular way, saying that it's courage, it's peace, it's prosperity of our nation. Look at what Gandhiji. Gandhiji was a very honest man. Gandhian secularism is a very positive, honest approach towards things. Back in 1921, he wrote on Harijan. This was the first flag. It was a person by Pingali Vengaya of Masuli Patanam who designed our flag at first. Gandhiji said, see, we have different faiths in India. India is a homeland to different faiths. So let us accommodate all the faiths in the world. We have Hindus, we have Muslims, we have Christians, we have Parsis, we have Jews, we have Sikhs, we have all the dharmic traditions of Buddhas, Jainas, and all the known religions and faiths in the world. Let us have a very inclusive flag. At that point of time, some ultra-wingers of some section said, we need to have only one color in our flag. Gandhiji said, it's not possible. Let us not overstretch our arguments. He was a social philosopher too. He said, I really respect saffron, but that doesn't mean saffron should be the only flag of India. He said, let us be pluralistic. Let us be accommodative. Let us respect all the faiths. And Gandhiji, this was the first flag which was adopted in 19, which was considered for adoption in 1931, with different faiths being defended by different colors, all the below color. And Gandhiji said a very interesting thing too. Let minorities have the first representation of our color and let majority take the final responsibility of upholding our constitution and nation. And later it evolved into a better representation of different colors. And Gandhiji believed all sections of people should be represented in our color. That's the reason why back in 1921, 13, 4, 1921, Gandhiji spoke about this flag. Gandhiji spoke about a consensus. See, this is the idea, and what we proudly, with great pride, what we proudly wear, this flag, is an idea of consensus between different identities, different spheres, different people. And the irrelevance of Gandhiji, the important relevance of Gandhiji in the modern era. See, what we earlier saw was different communities, different faiths and different religion. The modern world is also sharply split between left-wing and right-wing. If you can see right now, the right-wing populism is growing everywhere. May it be Donald Trump in Europe, may it be Brexit, as somebody mentioned earlier, may it be France. This right-wing authoritarian populism is going all the world. Same wise, you know, in the past century, left-wing had the upper hand with Russia, with China, different experiments of socialism and communism we had. If you look at the left versus right political spectrum, you know, I'm taking the US as an example first so that, you know, we will understand from a global perspective. This is the centrist space that they had. From the center to the left, they always had the liberals, the left liberals, as we call in the modern socio-political parlance in all the channels we have. We have socialism, communism, anarchism on the other side of Karl Marx. And on the other side, you have conservatism, family systems, monarchism, which is ruled by a king, something like Nazism, which Adolf Hitler tried, and something like fascism, which went to the other extreme extent, the right-wing extremism and the left-wing extremism on both extents. And what was Gandhiji's position? Gandhiji was a great center point in our Indian history where he consolidated the centrist space. You know, the left-leaning was Nehruji, right-leaning was Patel, but both could find great common ground in Gandhiji. That's the reason why, even after Sardar Vallabhai Patel won 12 out of the 15 Pradesh Congress committees, I mean, at that point of time, our national movement was Congress. 12 out of 15, Gandhiji told, in order to counterbalance, let Patel withdraw his nomination and let Nehru be the Prime Minister of India. See, Gandhiji had that moral authority, and when Pakistan was being created, when partition was being planned by some extremist forces, which right now moved into different spheres of the world, Gandhiji made Maulana Abdul Kalam Azad the president of the, at that present national movement. So Gandhiji was a person who could create a balancing centrist middle ground in the world. And look at the modern Indian socio-political phenomenon. This is the modern Indian spectrum for the past 60 years. On one side, the Nehru, the old Congress socialists, the communists, the leftists. On the other side, there is Patel, there is Rajaji, there is Shyama Prasad Mukherjee, the modern ruling dispensation. And both, and Gandhiji had a great vision, which he pointed out that, see, these both are very natural to any nation. In US, we call it the Democrats versus the Republicans. In India, you call it the right versus the left. This right versus the left, philosophically speaking, is the nature versus nurture debate we have learned. The genetics versus environment. The right wing gives more importance to genetics and less importance to environment. The left gives more importance to environment, education, behaviorism in psychology, and the less importance to genetics. This is how left and right will be there. These two perspectives will always be there. What we need, any nation needs, is a balance. The right focuses on growth. The left focuses on distribution. The consensus and synthesis is development, which is growth plus distribution. Economy and, earlier they said economy on one side, environment on the other side. How do you find a balance between the need to grow economy and the need to preserve environment on the other side? How to balance the feminist uprising at this point of time and yet preserve the family structure on the other? The world is a balance. The world is a kind of balance where a new order will emerge. And Gandhiji was a person who could guide the whole world in such an order in the past century. And if you look at, you know, whenever I go to colleges, I always hear them speaking about abilities, skill, so many other things. If you look at Indian history, with all great impartiality, I would say Gandhiji was perhaps the least skilled of all men. He was not as eloquent as Nehru. He was never a charming speaker like Nehru. He was never an able administrator like Sardar Vallabhai Patel, who was an iron man who could unify India. He was never a great system builder like Baba Saheb Ambedkar, who is a founder of our constitution. He was never charismatic as Netaji Bose, never a scholar as Maulana Abdul Kalam Azad, and he could never, you know, inspire the fiery passion that Bhagat Singh had. But yet, he became the Bapu of all. Yet he became the father of nation because more than ability, he was good at heart. He was a nice person. He was a person who was ready for consensus. He was a person who was ready to talk it out. He was a person who was ready to sacrifice himself in order for the larger interest of the nation. That's what happened in Pune Pact, where Madan Mohan Malaviya and Baba Saheb Ambedkar made consensus just to save Gandhi. Both had their own conflicting viewpoints. But even Ambedkar's wife went to Ambedkar and said, Mahatma, you know, you have to respect the life of Mahatma. And when he, as a patriarch, as a very senior person, requests something, we have to listen to his sagely says. And Mahatma Gandhi's greatness is that his approach, his ability, and the great poet of Indian freedom struggle, one of the great poets, poet Vallathol, said on Gandhiji, Gandhiji was a very common man. Gandhiji was not a very skilled man, the original ordinary man of India, the original normal person of India. But the greatness Gandhiji had was Gandhiji had the sacrificing mentality of Christ. He was a protector of Dharma like Sri Krishna. He had the perseverance of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He had the ahimsa of Buddha and he had the intellect of Shankara. More than his abilities, his attitude, his understanding of the nature, his need to bring people together. This is what the modern world is lacking, where people are very polarized. I'm lucky to be in many TV channel debates where even debates today are very polarizing. It is either black or white. Either you are there or you are here. Let us fight it out. You know, always the conflict idea is there rather than the idea of consensus. Earlier, when it was Doordarshan and the earlier point of time of our TV news industry, we were looking for consensus. We were looking for something that unites. Now we are looking for something that differentiates. We are looking for differences between people and how to make people fight in differences so that there is some amount of energy and noise on TV. The same thing is happening in the West, where Fox and CNN are on the both sides. The common points are missing. And Gandhian attitude is the idea of common points, bringing together people. Ideologies may be there, religions may be there, races may be there, languages may be there. But we need to have some kind of common grounds. And in a globalized world where we have around 194 nations, we have around 700 crore people, we many a times claim that we live in a global village. How do we live in a global village when there are so much differences? That's the reason why the right, Indian right, always emphasized on unity. Indian left always emphasized on diversity. And Gandhiji said, let us have unity in diversity. This is how you build a synthesis between thesis and antithesis. There is always a synthesis possible. And please remember, centrism doesn't mean you don't have an opinion. Being a centrist doesn't mean you are a fence-sitter. Being a centrist, a moderate, only means there are spaces where you can build bridges. And, you know, as my time comes to an end, what was Gandhiji's take on Gandhism? It's very interesting to note, what did Gandhiji say about Gandhism? Gandhiji said, there is no such thing as Gandhism, and I do not wish to leave any sect after me. I do not claim to have originated any new principle of doctrine. I have simply tried in my own way to apply the eternal truths to our life and problems. I may change them tomorrow, and I have nothing new to teach the world. Truth and nonviolence are as old as the mountains. Please remember, Gandhian positions, many of Gandhian philosophies may be outdated. I concede, even as a proud Gandhian, I concede. But having said that, that Gandhian approach is eternally alive. And Gandhian approach is needed for a multicultural, plural, very inclusive kind of world, whether you belong to right or left, whether you belong to a religion or a particular religion, whether you belong to one community or the other community, one nationality or the other nationality, there is always an essence of Gandhi. And when I can conclude, I would conclude by saying, the essence of Gandhism for me is this. Gandhian bridging barriers is what we need. Barriers may always be there, but Gandhism, I would say, be good, do good. There will always be issues and differences. Walls will always be there, but build doors and bridges. And bridges are one of the greatest creative ideas in human history. May you all be able to become a good bridge builder for the betterment of India and humanity. Thank you. Jai Hind.